Srila Prabhupada. The sages assembled in the forest of Naimisharanya inquired from Suta Goswami about the birth of Maharaj Parikshit, but in the course of the narration, other topics like the release of the Brahmastra by the son of Drona, his punishment by Arjuna, Queen Kunti Devi's prayers, the Pandavas' visit to the place where Bhishma Deva was lying, his prayers, and thereafter the Lord's departure for Dwaraka were discussed. His arrival at Dwaraka and residing with the 16,000 queens, etc., were narrated. The sages were absorbed in hearing such descriptions, but now they wanted to turn to the original topic, and thus the inquiry was made by Shaunaka Rishi. So the subject of the release of the Brahmastra weapon by Ashwatthama is renewed. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport. The Srimad Bhagavatam, as it is presented by Vyasadeva, begins with questions by the sages of Naimisharanya. They are engaged in performing a 1,000-year sacrifice. But this sacrifice is a special sacrifice. It is a sacrifice of hearing and chanting. The sages of Naimisharanya have assembled to hear the glories of Krishna. And Suta Goswami is speaking about Krishna's glories. Now it is presented in the form of questions and answers. The sages of Naimisharanya are asking questions, and Suta Goswami is replying, giving the answers to their questions. Now the initial six questions that were asked by the sages led to discussions about the topic of Krishna. Suta Goswami was very much enlivened when he heard the questions asked by the sages of Naimisharanya, as they were very eager to hear about Krishna. Yat krita krishna samprashno yenatma suprasidati munaya sadhu prushtoham bhavadbhir lokamangala. Suta Goswami, after hearing the initial questions, he says that your questions are just proper, perfect, because they are meant for the welfare of the entire world. Why does he say that? Because your questions pertain to the subject matter of Krishna. Krishna samprashno. So after replying to their questions, initial questions, Suta Goswami is inspired to speak more about Krishna, because they are very eager to hear about Krishna. So he says, I shall narrate the Srimad Bhagavatam as I heard from Shukadeva Goswami when he was speaking to Parikshit Maharaj. So these sages are very happy that Suta Goswami is going to recite the Srimad Bhagavatam. But before Suta Goswami can begin reciting the Bhagavatam, the sages ask further questions. They say, please tell us, when and where did Vyasadeva compile the Srimad Bhagavatam? That is because Vyasadeva had compiled many, many, many varieties of Vedic literature. And Srimad Bhagavatam happens to be the last work of Vyasadeva. So, in questioning the details about this compilation of Bhagavatam by Vyasadeva, the sages want to know what was the reason for Vyasadeva to compile the Bhagavatam, and how did he get the inspiration to compile the Bhagavatam. Suta Goswami begins to describe that, and that leads to further topics being inquired by the sages. When they heard that Bhagavatam was spoken by Shukadev Goswami, they want to know more about Shukadev Goswami. Because Shukadev Goswami, by birth, he was a liberated soul. So how is it that he studied the Bhagavatam? Liberated souls don't study Vedic literature. Because the purpose of the Vedic literatures is to attain liberation. So if he is already liberated, what is the need for him to study the Vedic literature? So this actually helps us understand Bhagavatam is meant not only for those who desire liberation, but it is also meant for the liberated souls. That is explained by, that is mentioned by Vyasadeva, the author, right in the beginning. That this Srimad Bhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavate Mahamunikrute Kimva Paraihi, what literature can be better than the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is compiled by the great sage Vyasadeva? Kimva Paraihi. And he also says that this Bhagavatam is a special literature which is nigama kalpatador galitam phalam shukamukhadamrutadravasam yutam. It is the ripened fruit of the Vedic tree of knowledge. So it is very relishable. A fruit contains the essence of a tree, which is the seed. Because from the seed you can get another tree. So the essence of the tree is the seed, which contains the tree itself. But the fruit is the most relishable part of the tree. Just like if you have a mango tree. The seed of the mango tree is very valuable because you can get one more mango tree with that seed. But then, the most relishable part of the tree is the fruit. So Bhagavatam is so nice that it not only has the essence of the entire Vedic literature, which is the Vedanta Sutra. So Bhagavatam contains Vedanta Sutra. But it also has the most relishable part of the Vedas. That is the rasa. The most relishable part of the tree is the fruit. And the fruit also is more relishable if it is juicy, if it has got rasa. So Bhagavatam contains the most essential, relishable part of the Vedic tree of knowledge, that is the rasa, bhakti rasa. So therefore, Vyasadeva says, nigama kalpataror galitam phalam, the ripened fruit of the Vedic tree of knowledge is the Srimad Bhagavatam. Shukamukhad, and when it came out of the lips of Shukadev Goswami, that which was already relishable became more so, amrutadrava samyutam. A fruit is relishable when it is fully ripened. And a ripened fruit, the further essence of the ripened fruit is its nectarian juice, rasa. So here, in this verse, the word rasa is used to understand the relishable part of self-realization. Self-realization leads to enlightenment about who we are and leads to liberation from material bondage. But more relishable or most relishable part of self-realization is tasting the nectar of our relationship with the Supreme, which is the advanced stage of self-realization. Complete self-realization means knowing three things. Knowing who we are, that is certainly the important aspect of self-realization. But also knowing who is God, Krishna, the absolute truth. So complete self-realization involves knowing two selves, the individual self and the supreme self, Krishna. And the relishable part of this knowledge is the understanding of the relationship. Understanding of the relationship. And that relationship is a loving relationship with Krishna. And the relishable part of that loving relationship is the exchange of love between the devotee and the Supreme Lord Krishna in varieties of bhakti rasa. So that is the subject matter of the Bhagavatam. Not only the Bhagavatam helps us in self-realization, but it also helps us to go further and perfect our self-realization, to know Krishna, our relationship with Krishna, and the exchange of bhakti rasa in our relationship with Krishna, in activities centered around the relationship. So this is expressed by Vyasadeva as Nigama Kalpataror Galitam Phalam Shukamukharamruta Dravasam Yutam Pibata Bhagavatam Rasamalayam. Now this Bhagavata Rasa is relishable by everybody, but particularly, who are the candidates who can best relish? They are the liberated souls. The liberated souls are the best candidates for relishing. So, topics of Bhagavatam are actually meant for those who are liberated souls. But Shukadeva Goswami's presentation is so nice that even those who are not liberated, they can also relish the Srimad Bhagavatam if they hear from a devotee situated in pure devotional service. If they hear from a pure devotee, then even those who are not liberated can actually become immediately liberated and can become eligible to relish the bhakti rasa which is presented by Vyasadeva. So, Shukamukhad, this Bhagavatam, which was actually compiled by Vyasadeva, but which is spoken by Shukadeva Goswami to Parikshit Maharaj, that becomes more relishable as it comes out of the lips of Shukadeva Goswami. And this is the only literature among all Vedic literatures which is relishable by the liberated souls. The liberated souls are not interested in hearing about how to attain self-realization, because they are already, or how to attain liberation, they are not interested in that because they are already liberated. So rather, they are interested in something which is meant especially for the liberated souls, and that is Srimad Bhagavatam. So the sages of Naimisharanya are very eager to hear about Bhagavatam, but before Suta Goswami can speak about the Bhagavatam, they are asking questions pertaining to Shukadeva Goswami, pertaining to the author Vyasadeva, pertaining to Parikshit Maharaj, who sat and heard the Srimad Bhagavatam continuously for 7 days. So what were the circumstances that led Parikshit Maharaj to renounce his kingdom, which he was ruling very nicely? He was the perfect ruler after Yudhishthira, after the Pandavas. He was enthroned as the emperor of the world, the most qualified Kshatriya of his time. He was ruling the world very nicely. So why did he renounce his kingdom before he could actually become old enough to retire? He renounced it even when he was young. Why did he do so? What is the reason? And also, the sages are inquiring, Parikshit was a great devotee. So we want to hear about the birth of this Emperor Parikshit. His birth, his activities, his renouncing the kingdom, and especially his hearing the Srimad Bhagavatam. All this we want to hear in great detail. So therefore, Suta Goswami is answering all their other questions before he begins to recite the Srimad Bhagavatam. So the topics were discussed by Suta Goswami about how is it that this Parikshit Maharaj was born. The birth of Emperor Parikshit is very special. That he was in his mother's womb, and his father, Parikshit's father, Abhimanyu, the son of Arjuna, he died before Parikshit was born. He died in the battle of Kurukshetra. And this Ashwatthama, who was fighting, the son of Drona, who was fighting on the side of the Kauravas, in order to please his master, Duryodhana, he wanted to kill the Pandavas. So he was unable to fight against the Pandavas and kill them, even though he was a powerful warrior, a Kshatriya. He was not a Kshatriya, he was the son of a Brahmana. But still, he was an expert fighter. He was unable to kill the Pandavas. So, while the 5 sons of Draupadi, who were born through the 5 Pandavas, were sleeping, this Ashwatthama mistook them to be the Pandavas and killed them while they were sleeping, the Upa Pandavas, because their faces resembled the face of the Pandavas. So, he mistakenly thought they are the Pandavas. And he could not actually defeat them in a proper battle, so he decided somehow let me kill them. And what did he do? He killed the five sleeping sons of the Pandavas. And he brought those five heads to show to Duryodhana that I have killed the Pandavas. But Duryodhana immediately recognized these are not the Pandavas. These are the sons of the Pandavas. So Duryodhana condemned when he learned that this Ashwatthama had killed them while they were sleeping. Duryodhana condemned this Ashwatthama's heinous act of killing them. And Ashwatthama realized he is not able to please his master and he has not killed the Pandavas. Then he realized that now his life is in danger. The Pandavas are not dead. So immediately he started to run away when Arjuna came to catch this Ashwatthama, to punish this Ashwatthama, who had killed unjustly the five sons of Draupadi. So, in order to escape from Arjuna, Ashwatthama tried to run away, but he could not. And then he released one Brahmastra. And that was also counteracted by Arjuna on the instruction of Krishna. And then again, of course, Ashwatthama was then captured by Arjuna. He should have been killed, but since he was the son of Dronacharya, the son of a Brahmana, he was not exactly killed, but he was punished in a befitting manner by Arjuna, and he was just his jewel on the head was taken away, his hair was cut off, and he was sent away after having been punished through insult. So his life was spared because he was the son of a Brahmana. And after he was released, after the punishment, he decided to kill the last surviving descendant of the Pandavas, and that was the grandson of Arjuna, the son of Abhimanyu. While son of Abhimanyu, Parikshit, was in the womb of his mother, so he released another Brahmastra to kill this last surviving descendant, Parikshit, in the womb of his mother. And this Brahmastra is such a weapon, when it is directed towards a particular person, the Brahmastra will go searching for that person wherever the person is and only kill that person. This is the way the Brahmastra works. And it is, as it is described here, invincible. It cannot be counteracted ordinarily by any other weapon. No other weapon can be used to counteract the Brahmastra. So Uttara, the mother of Parikshit, she actually was very advanced in in recognizing that this Brahmastra is coming to destroy her child in the womb. So she approached Krishna and prayed to Krishna that this Brahmastra is coming to actually destroy the embryo, my child. So I pray that this child be protected, even though I may die, that's okay, due to the Brahmastra entering my womb. I may die, but she's praying to Krishna, kindly protect the child. Krishna, in response to her prayer, entered her womb and nullified the effect of the Brahmastra and saved both the mother and the child. Why? Because both were devotees of Krishna. Both were devotees of Krishna. Krishna's devotees are never vanquished. He tells Arjuna, declare, Name Bhakta Pranashyati. My devotee is never vanquished by anybody. Not possible. So Ashwatthama could not actually kill that child. So Parikshit's birth is extraordinary because he was saved by Krishna in his mother's womb itself, even before his birth, even before he came out of his mother's womb. So extraordinary birth. And then this chapter is going to describe what all happened, auspicious things at the time of his birth. How he was raised by his grandparents, because Parikshit's father died in the battle, even before Parikshit could be born. So how he was nicely cared for and trained up by his grandparents. And later chapters will describe Parikshit's activities as the emperor of the world. This is going to lead to the description of Parikshit meeting, being cursed by the son of a Brahmana, and his renouncing the kingdom and preparing for death. In the course of preparing for death, he happened to meet Shukadev Goswami, and he inquired from Shukadev Goswami that led to Shukadev Goswami speaking the Bhagavatam to Parikshit Maharaj. So in between, so many topics are coming up, but the sages of Naimisharanya are hearing very attentively. After one question is answered, they are actually asking the next question, the next question, the next question. So they are very alert in hearing Suta Goswami speak or answer their questions. And they are asking the most relevant questions. All the questions are leading to topics about Krishna being discussed. Topics about Krishna are not only directly describing Krishna, his activities, his qualities, his glories, but also the glories of Krishna's pure devotees. Especially those devotees who are directly participating in Krishna's pastimes. So, Parikshit was personally saved by Krishna in his mother's womb. So that description is also given here on the request of the sages of Naimisharanya, headed by Shaunaka Rishi. Shaunaka Rishi is the spokesperson for the sages. Many sages had assembled to hear from Suta Goswami. So Shaunaka Rishi is their spokesperson. So he is the learned, eldest, Vedantist. He is the most qualified. So he is asking the questions. Here he is telling, the womb of Uttara, mother of Maharaj Parikshit, was spoiled by the dreadful and invincible Brahmastra weapon released by Ashwatthama. Actually, the power of the Brahmastra is such that Parikshit should have died in his mother's womb. But Maharaj Parikshit was saved by the Supreme Lord. There is a saying in Bengali, Mare Krishna Rakshe Ke. And Rakshe Krishna Mare Ke. If Krishna decides to kill somebody, nobody can protect that person. Nobody can save that person. Not possible. And if Krishna decides to protect somebody, nobody can kill that person. So, in the case of Ravana, when Ravana's life was in danger, when he was fighting against Rama, and Rama was going to shoot that final arrow to kill Ravana, at that time, Parvati was observing that Shiva's devotee, Ravana, his life is in danger. Then she appealed to Lord Shiva, "Your devotee's life is in danger. Won't you do something to save him?" So then Shiva says, "If the Supreme Lord decides to kill somebody, nobody can save that person, including me." Because among the devatas, Brahma is the chief, the most powerful. But greater than Brahma is Lord Shiva in terms of having power in this world. But even Shiva's power is limited. Only Vishnu or Krishna has unlimited power. Unlimited power is only with Vishnu or Krishna. So therefore, more powerful than Shiva is Vishnu. And when Vishnu means any incarnation, personal incarnation of the Supreme Lord Krishna, all the different personalities of Godhead in various forms, various incarnations. When they decide to kill somebody, then Shiva also cannot save them. So therefore, Shiva says to Parvati that I cannot save this Ravana when his life is in danger, being attacked by Lord Rama. Not possible. Here, now, Ashwatthama, he has released his Brahmastra to kill Parikshit. Now, nobody can save Parikshit except Krishna. Nobody can save Parikshit except Krishna. So Krishna personally entered, that description is there in the later verses, the womb of Parikshit's mother, Uttara, and saved Parikshit from that Brahmastra. So the sages of Naimisharanya are requesting Sita Goswami, kindly describe this wonderful pastime of the Supreme Lord, the glorious act of the Supreme Lord personally saving this Parikshit Maharaj and subsequent birth of Parikshit, how it was extraordinary at a most auspicious time. Such great devotees take birth in this world. Also, the Supreme Lord, when he appears at the most auspicious time. So, the appearance of the Supreme Lord and his pure devotees in this world is actually happening at the most auspicious time. Most auspicious time. So by simply studying the birth chart, the horoscope of the appearance of the Supreme, birth of the Supreme Lord and his pure devotees, one can understand that their birth is not at all like anybody else's birth. Mahatmanaha, the word that is used for pure devotees by Krishna himself in the Bhagavad Gita. Mahatmanastu mam partha daivim prakritim ashritah. The pure devotees, they are always under the shelter, under the protection of Krishna's internal potency. That same internal potency Krishna employs for his own activities, for his own appearance. That also Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. Ajopi san avyayatma bhutanam ishwaropi san prakritim swam adishthaya sambhavami atmamayaya. Krishna's birth is described as sambhavami. That means he appears. He does not take birth like ordinary people, like any created being. No. He appears for the vision of the people of this world by his internal potency, atmamayaya. Similarly, the devotees, the pure devotees, appear in this world, take birth in this world, under the protection of Krishna's internal potency. So their birth, their activities, everything is completely transcendental. It is not governed by the laws of karma. They are all transcendental to the material laws. Therefore, their birth chart is extraordinarily auspicious. Extraordinarily auspicious. When Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, the guru of Srila Prabhupada, was born, a learned astrologer made the birth chart and said, all the 32 symptoms of a Mahapurusha are there in this child. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared, was born, Nilambara Chakravarti, a very learned astrologer, made the birth chart and noticed the 32 symptoms of the Mahapurusha. When Krishna was born, Garga Muni made the chart and saw all the 32 symptoms of a Mahapurusha. So there are extraordinary symptoms of the appearance of the Lord and his pure devotees that a learned person can clearly identify. It is not a matter of some belief or sentiment of some people. We think he is God or we think he is pure devotee. No. There is a science behind this. And there are elaborate scriptures written. Those who study astrology properly, they can study this astrological calculations which can help a learned astrologer identify who is a pure devotee of the Lord simply by studying the birth chart. Or even studying the birth chart of Krishna, they can identify Krishna as the incarnation of the Supreme Lord. So this is the science of astrology, Jyotishya Shastra. It is one of the Vedangas. Vedangas. There are six auxiliary subjects in study of the Vedas, original Vedas. The Vedas, when we say Vedas, it means, one meaning is all branches of knowledge. But it also means specifically the branch of knowledge which is dealing with the subject matter of spirituality, Atma Vidya or Brahma Vidya. But auxiliary to this Brahma Vidya or Atma Vidya is this six Vedangas to help us study this Atma Vidya, Vyakarana, grammar, Chandas, how the verses are composed in the original Vedas, metrical composition by the great sages. And then this Jyotisha Shastra. Jyotisha Shastra is especially for identifying, simply by studying the birth chart, the appearance or the birth of the Supreme Lord in his incarnations, various incarnations, and the appearance or the birth of the pure devotees. Even when Prabhupada was born, one learned astrologer in Navadvip said, this child is going to grow up and be the preacher of Sanatan Dharma, and he's going to actually cross the seven seas and preach all over the world the glories of the Bhagavata Dharma. So this prediction was already made by one learned astrologer in Navadvip. So it is a fact. This is a science. This science of astrology. It is not some belief system that somebody is pure devotee or somebody is by birth. By birth, somebody is a pure devotee. It is not a belief system. So accordingly, when Parikshit was born, Yudhishthira Maharaj had learned sages, prepared the birth chart, and the sages spoke about the greatness of this Parikshit as a pure devotee. That will be described in this chapter by Suta Goswami. So I'll stop here. Grantharat Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.